You're watching HCAM's educational channel, where you can find the latest educational content from our community. HCAM helps provide educational content produced by students, faculty, and staff of the Hingham Public School System. For more Hingham community updates, tune into HCAM's government channel on Comcast 9 and Verizon Fios 30, and HCAM's public channel on Comcast 97 and Verizon Fios 31.
Today is our 8th annual Hingham High School Sophomore History Day. This is a day where the faculty members walk students over from the Hingham High School, the 10th grade class, in two block sessions. And they learn a little bit about Hingham's hidden gem, which is the Grand Armory of the Republic Memorial Hall. This is the building that we're in now. It's of museum quality, houses all the veteran artifacts from the current conflicts back to the Civil War.
It gives the kids, I hope, a chance to hear a variety of experiences by men and women who have served in the military. I've thought about it often. I wish I'd had the same opportunity when I was in high school to have heard folks that served in World War II and the Korean War kind of speak about their experiences, because it gives you a perspective, I'd like to think, that's adds to what they're hearing in the classroom.
So believe it or not, just like any good, well-run event, we begin in the fall when the kids, the students go back to school. We meet with the faculty, the department head usually, just to say, hey, this is on again for this year. Yeah, very preliminary. As winter rolls through and after the Christmas break, we start to nail down specific topics that are going to be covered that'll coincide with what they're learning at the time. This particular field trip, since I mentioned, is a walking field trip, so it's imperative that we have it in April when the weather is more akin to having that type of activity. So we then plan out the date, barring any snow days, which we had to add 4 this year. And the date's flexible, but so are the veterans. And I know they really enjoy being here telling their story, and it's very important to them to pass that on to this next generation, so they'll be our future leaders.
It's interesting, when I first started this, there were some individuals that had fought in World War II, and another individual who was Marine Air, I think, in the Korean War, that used to come and speak. But they're well into their 80s. One is in his early 90s. But they represent, and I think we represent, a variety of services, and within those services, specialties. So I'm thinking that the kids get a pretty good summary cross-section of the various branches of the military, which do different things, have different responsibilities, as well as the time frames. I mean, it's even for me, when I listen to Herm Mesmer and before Charlie Chittick talk about the Korean War and what they were doing, I learned things. And so I enjoy this just because each year, although I've heard these gentlemen speak previously, each year it's always a little different. You hear something new. So I personally benefit from it. I think you hear, as I say, different services and different specialties within the service.
Talking about past wars and the more recent conflicts and, you know, what's going on in the world today with Syria and Korea, you know, being in our sights. I think it's just the information that comes out of these guys, these men and women that speak, is incredible. And I don't feel like a lot of history books portray how we can talk about it. And I feel like speaking in person is always better than watching something on YouTube or something like that. I feel like it reaches out to more people that way.
Everything you see in the hall that's framed up on the walls, the pictures, these are real artifacts that have been saved through grant money and through our current Board of Selectmen, who from the 1940s have passed on this trust. This is a public building. There are 3 members that are appointed annually. Mr. Bob Beal is a trustee, Mr. Scott McMillan, trustee, and Mr. Frank Sheelan is a trustee. They conduct the day-to-day operations here. They keep the lights on. They get the money for all of us to come here and enjoy not only today, but throughout the year. Again, this is a part of history. So the things that are in here that you see, if it says 1865 on it, it's really from 1865, okay? So it is my pleasure now to introduce Ernie Sofus. Ernie is the historian for this building who's appointed by those trustees that I mentioned. He was also a veteran himself, having served in the Korean War as a first lieutenant in the U.S. Army Quartermaster Corps. So without further ado, Ernie Sofus.
Let's give him another big hand, because he's a heck of a guy. Come on. Good morning.
Good morning.
Let's do it again. Good morning.
Good morning.
Thanks, ladies and gentlemen. It's a pleasure to be here, and it's a pleasure to have you. And I have 5 minutes. That's what he said. 5 minutes only. So I've got to talk fast. As Keith mentioned to us, this building was built and presented to the town May 23rd, 1888. And in the last 2 or 3 years, we had our 125th anniversary of the building. There were 191 buildings built like this, Grand Army of the Republic Memorial. 191 in the Commonwealth of Massachusetts. So over 50% of the cities and towns that represent the Commonwealth had a building like this, which is remarkable. There were 40,000 members. We're dedicated and determined to keep this building open for the veterans and for you and for the town. I said to you there were 191 buildings in 1888. Today there are 10, and this is one of the 10 in the Commonwealth of Massachusetts. And we're going to keep it there. There are dedicated veterans, and you folks will keep it going. I want to tell you briefly about the G.A.R., the Grand Army of the Republic members, if you will. And they were universal throughout the Civil War, and they are the ones that dedicated themselves to perpetuating, continuing the future of that organization, and that's why we're here. There was, in that Civil War, the worst massacre, the worst death rate, if you will, of military of any war that we've had, the First World War or the Second War combined. There were more men and women who were killed in the Civil War. It was a horrendous, horrendous time. So we're going to talk this morning. We're still morning. We're going to talk this morning, and we've got several veterans that I want to introduce to you. We're going to have a Herm Mesmer, who will tell us about being in Korea. And Korea's back in the headlines, as we know, based upon what's going on in North Korea. But he'll tell us about his spectacular dedication and time in Korea. Regrettably, and this is regrettable, he was a Vietnam veteran, and unfortunately, Dave Sargent cannot be with us this morning. He took ill last night, and so he will not be with us. He is one hero, let me tell you. For the Cold War period, we have John Asher, who's right here, and you'll enjoy his comments, I'm certain. Bob Fournier. Bob will talk to us about Desert Storm, Iraq, and he's good too. And finally, we have Jessica Pedrosa and her mother, Would you two lovely ladies hold up your hands? Okay. They're going to talk to us about Iraq and a mother-daughter relationship in the military, which is under any circumstance unique, and that for us in Hingham to have them is remarkable. And at the same time, Keith German will tell us some more about his, I think, 6 tours of duties in the Middle East. Was that the correct number? That's remarkable, folks. We have one other gentleman here, Don Lincoln. Don, you want to raise your hand, please? Don is here to talk to about that ship, and it's, everyone in the room would know that. I don't, because I'm from Pittsburgh, and you know, we don't know whether it's a boat or a ship, but that's a ship, right? Right, Don?
Right.
He'll tell us he spent 4 years in the Navy, and we'll, if you want to hear some exciting stories, come up while he's up there. And finally, I just want to say that when you're taking your break, come up and enjoy some lemonade and a cookie with the compliments of Whole Foods at the South Weymouth store. Thank you so much, and enjoy your morning.
Thank you, Ernie. If I could get Corporal Herm Mesmer, United States Army, Korea, front and center.
Good morning, everybody. Can everybody hear me back there? Okay. This is the class of 2020.
2019.
Oh, 2019. Oh, okay, good. You got a lot to look forward to. I'm here to give you a little. I'm here to give you a little insight into a period of time in my life back in 1952, 1953 when I went to Korea, and I want to give you some insight into the things that happened to me after I left the service. I know you can't see this. This is a map of Korea. And that's all right, you don't have to see it. All you have to know is across the middle, we have a line of demarcation. We called it the MLR, the main line of resistance. And this is the 38th parallel. And the important thing about 38th parallel tells you it's, we're at the 42nd parallel. So 38th, hey, that must be down around Philadelphia. So the weather can't be bad, but the weather was horrible. Okay, and it comes from Manchuria. The Manchurian winds would blow down here. And the winters were very cold, and I spent a winter and a half. We went over on a cruise ship. This is the cruise ship I went over on. It was a military transport, and it carried about 2,000 men, and it was terrible, let me tell you, because the guys were, everybody got sick. I never saw so many seasick people, and it took 10 days to go to Yokohama, and from there we got distributed to Korea, to an organization, depending on what you were trained on. Next. When you got to Korea, we landed in Incheon. And this is a famous location, because this is where Douglas MacArthur pulled a surprise attack and landed in Incheon after the North Koreans had invaded. Okay, it's right here. They had invaded, came down here, and we cut them off with this landing by Douglas MacArthur. The bad news about this thing, it was had very low a low tide, and they were restricted into how when they could get in there with boats. That's why we went in by LSTs. And you can see the hospital ship in the background. What we had greeting us a lot of times, I just want to point out that the people that lived there had they were poor. And during the war, it was exceptionally bad for them. It was sad, all right? And they were always out begging. And, and the troops we were landing there, we throw cigarettes and things like that, and money, cigarettes. And but while I was there, I was very impressed by the people, how hardworking they were, and how poor they were. But, they were happy eating things. Kids would come up to a barbed wire fence chewing on something, and I didn't know what it was. Well, I thought it was candy, but they were chewing on dried octopus, you know, and that was a big deal. They loved it. And this was my first assignment. We had a station with one of the 35th Infantry Regiment, and we had our antennas up here, but this was the main line of resistance down there, and you can see the weather was cold, all right? This was a view from that same location I just showed you, only looking backwards. And that little outhouse there, that's an outhouse. That was our facility. There's our tent there and our lines. And what we did is we took all the telephone lines for communication that came from the regimental headquarters. We came up to our truck and we put them on a carrier bay and wrote them on top of a VHF signal and sent it by line of sight back to the division. It was really the top kind of communication back in those days. And but what happens is we had to be very mobile. We were always in a remote location like this, and took a lot of work. And one of the worst times I remember is a move. The division decided to move in the middle of the night, and you talk about chaos, pulling things up. You can't see where you're going. And I ended up driving a deuce and a half truck, which is a 2.5 ton truck, and which I hadn't driven very much. In the middle of the night, all you have are these little slits in it for lighting. And we moved that division. We moved in 24 hours. And then we can do this. And this is looking at some of the main line of resistance that we could see from some of our locations. And you can see the antenna. It looks like a TV antenna, and it is the same configuration as a TV antenna. Okay? And this was our facilities that I had to put up with for 13 months when I was there. It's it's an outhouse, and it's an ammunition case that we cut a hole in it, and it worked, you know, and you just get used to it. But you don't get used, you do and you don't get used to stuff like that. You've been on camping trips. You know, it's always good to go home. It's a hot and cold running water and things like that, you know, sleep in your own bed. Okay. All right, those are some of the scenes that I went through for 13 months. I wanted to tell you also about the food we ate. Okay, most of the time we could go to a field kitchen, either with the regimental headquarters that we were at, or they would pull up locally in a nearby neighborhood, or we had these things called sea rations. You probably are hearing the rations. You'll hear more from Keith about the kinds of rations he had, and they're quite improved, I have to say. You know, we got these canned meals, okay, and then we also had cans that had crackers in them, cocoa. Cigarettes, you'd always get a 4-pack of cigarettes with a can like that. And, you know, you'd get spaghetti and meatballs. And one of them, which turned into, which was awful, was ham and lima beans. Ugh! Now, after 3 months, I liked them. It was really very good filling and, you know, good digestive process with it. So, all right, where was I? Okay, Stan. So anyway, I was there 13 months. The war ended in June, or July, it was a treaty. And as you see today, it's still going on. Korea is still a hot spot. And we've got 25,000 troops over there, you know, and it's a dangerous place because of the group that's leading the North Korean people. I also wanted to show you my jacket. This is an Eisenhower jacket. These are the ribbons I accumulated in the 3 years. This is a citation from the president of South Korea. It's a presidential unit citation. It was given to my division while I was in it, so I was very proud of that. I don't know exactly what we did, but you know, somebody was always doing something fantastic. And there's our symbol, 25th Infantry Division, the great division. I'm very proud of it. I'm a member of the association. Every 6 years we go to Hawaii, okay, and have a reunion. Aloha! Okay, these stripes down here, each stripe represents 6 months in the overseas. So you can see I had two of them. They gave me two of them. And also I put a zipper. This is not regular issue. You get buttons when they give you this jacket. I have a zipper put on, and I wonder if I can get into this thing. Yeah, would you help me?
Sure.
This has been how many years? Oh, 53. This is what? 60. See? Got it. Oh, got it. Thank you.
All right. There you go.
I just wanted to say this cut, this was not normal regulation to cut a jacket off like this. If you look, you see these blouses over here. They're full length, they're down to here. General Eisenhower, remember that name, Eisenhower? He was a president, the 34th president. Yes. Well, when he was commander of the army that invaded in France, he decided he didn't like that long blouse, and he wanted a shorter one. And this became, he had it made, and this became the standard issue for everybody. So we all got an Ike jacket. That's where that term came from, the Ike jacket. So I want you to see that. Okay, then, the other thing is, I was over there as an electronics technician, and actually I was a radio repairman, and I didn't repair any radios, because if something broke, it was so critical, we swapped it out. We didn't fool around with the oscilloscopes and things like that. And then, when I got out of the service, I got a job with GE. I went to a tech school, then I got a job with GE. And I was lucky enough to get into the computer division. And the computer division all of a sudden exploded. And I was a field tech, and all of a sudden I was a district manager. All of a sudden I was a branch manager. All of a sudden I was director of technical support for the Eastern operations. And then I ended up as the regional manager in New England. Tech school graduate, okay? You got to get up, you got to work, guys. We need leaders. You got to step up and do dirty work and get it done. Take charge. I want to make that point today because it's so important that we need that kind of personnel in this country. Okay. Get a good education, work hard. All right. Now, the other thing is, I was in a war. I was trained to fight, trained to kill. The North Koreans were enemy. Okay. And it was a very scary situation. The first couple of months I was due, and I was on assignment, I slept with my rifle, okay? And that wasn't an easy thing to do. You'll see the rifle back there. But that's how, you know, worried you are about things. Then, I came home, I had three kids, they all went to high school here, and one of them went to college and got married, and she married a Korean. And I am the lucky man to have this wonderful granddaughter, Sophie, okay, who's half Korean, half German-Irish. That causes some problems, German-Irish. I'm a lucky man, but it just shows you that you never know what's going to happen in today's times. And people are people, all right? People are wonderful, all right? It's some of the leadership we get some problem. And that's all I have to say, and I say, you know, I salute the class of 2019. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Herm. Great job. Thank you, Herm. Our next speaker, as was mentioned, is not available today. He was going to tell us a little bit about Vietnam, but our very next speaker is Lieutenant United States Navy John Asher, who served during that time. He is going to briefly touch on that, but mostly what went on in his life as a naval officer. John Asher.
Thank you very much. Good morning, everybody. I'm here to talk about the Cold War, which you may have studied a little bit about so far. And I think most people think that the Cold War ended about 1991 with the collapse of the Soviet Union. I would say stay tuned, given what's happening now with Russia and North Korea. This is like a movie that I think I've not only seen, but I've been in. So let me tell you a little bit about it. First, let me ask a question. How many of you have seen the movie The Matrix? Oh, great. Okay. Well, for those of you that haven't, it's about a computer hacker whose name is Neo, who thinks that there is something not quite right about the world that he's living in, and through some various devices ends up with a meeting with a character, somewhat sinister character, whose name is Morpheus. And Morpheus presents Neo with a choice, which is to take a red pill or a blue pill. If he takes the red pill, Neo will understand and learn about the Matrix. If Neo takes the blue pill, he'll end up back in his bed and won't even remember that the meeting occurred. Okay. So, midway through my first year of graduate school, I enlisted in the Navy. A month later, actually about a month before the Tet Offensive in Vietnam, which was an invasion of the South. The Viet Cong executed a series of military exercises in the South that our military didn't think were possible. Several months before I was due to enter officer candidate school, I was summoned to a meeting with two Navy officers who seemed to know a great deal about me. How I'd done in college, math major, I'd done computer programming, and at one point spoke pretty fluent German. And they told me that if I were able to pass the very extensive background investigation for the security clearance that would be required, that they thought I might be a good fit for a secret unit in the US Navy. Couldn't tell me what it did, couldn't tell me where it did it, but they ended up saying it only took the best. So I took the red pill. And I ended up being, after I was commissioned as a cryptologic officer, I was sent to a secret base in Japan and spent about a year there, and then received orders to go to the National Security Agency, which at the time was so secret that NSA was said to stand for no such agency. It is also known as the Puzzle Palace. And I now see it on the evening news and read about it in the newspapers fairly frequently, which is still somewhat startling to me. What NSA does is collects what's called SIGINT, Signals Intelligence. And that's the business that I was in. It is the collection of any electronic emission by any of the potential adversaries of the United States and the analysis of those electronic communications. Communications security is also a responsibility of the National Security Agency, and COMSEC means we try to prevent adversaries of the United States from doing to us what we're collecting from them. So it's a defensive measure. And cyber intelligence is a more recent development. But that signals intelligence is gathered on what are called platforms. And those platforms are displayed, or a number of them are displayed here, basically from land bases, from surface ships, submarines, aircraft, more recently satellites. The one thing that wasn't really operational back 50 years ago were server farms. Now you grew up with the internet. The internet really has as its foundation what we were using back in the day, which was called ARPANET. ARPA, Advanced Research Projects Agency, was a network that connected installations like the National Security Agency with universities that were doing research, typically for the Department of Defense. If I were to ask you what intelligence operation in our country you think is the biggest and the most highly budgeted, populated, probably most of you would say the Central Intelligence Agency, CIA. In fact, NSA is about four times as large in terms of personnel and budget. So I spent 3+ years doing that. After I returned to civilian life, I joined IBM and spent several years working at the White House, supporting their computer systems, ran projects with the Central Intelligence Agency, Defense Intelligence Agency, and a lot of other intelligence operations, some of which didn't even have names. So what did I learn? Well, first what I learned was that I had been living in the Matrix when I was your age. There was a world out there that I really had had very little appreciation of, and I learned a great deal more about it when I saw beyond the Matrix, if you will, that there were a lot of entities in the world that whose missions were basically to exact harm upon us, our country, and our way of life, and that there were thousands of men and women who were working 24 hours a day to basically protect us and our way of life. A lot of them, particularly in the intelligence world, who were doing that intentionally, invisibly, and without much heralding, but really instrumental in enabling us to live the life that we enjoy then and still. Specifically, I learned, once I got to see the logs and such, how close we came as a country to all-out nuclear war with the Soviet Union during the Cuban Missile Crisis of 1962, where the Soviet Union was planting intercontinental ballistic missiles in Cuba, 90 miles from Florida. The flight time fast enough that we would not have any real meaningful reaction time should those missiles have been launched. I also learned about the capture of the USS Pueblo, which was a security group ship, the group I was in, by the North Koreans in 1968. And I would say not a proud chapter in the US Navy's history, not so much because of the crew on the ship, but the fact that the US Navy really didn't come to their aid as the North Koreans were firing upon them and eventually capturing it. The Iran-Contra affair, which you may have studied about, won't go into too much detail, but will say that I know the backstory of that since I was involved working with the FBI as we kind of unraveled that chapter in our history in 1985. So, what does all this have to do with you, my experiences 50 years ago? Well, I would say, first, I would offer, think about the fact that you live in the Matrix right now. You enjoy living in an environment that unfortunately is not representative of most of what's happening in the rest of the world. And I think should be grateful for it. I know I am. But we're enjoying that at the expense of people who are working to defend us from individuals and entities that would harm us. So, knowing that, as hard as it is to believe right now, class of 2019, in a few very short years, your generation is going to be running the country. And unfortunately, when you assume that responsibility, you're going to find that you're going to have to manage to the real world. So like it or not, you all will be taking the red pill too. And I would say the best way to prepare for that, and Mr. Hoey did not pay me to say this, is to learn as much about the real world as you can by studying and reading history. You'll find a number of things to be true, at least I have. One, motivations don't change. Circumstances may, but human motivations don't. As George Santayana said, those that haven't learned from history are doomed to repeat it. Another way to say the same thing is the only thing new in the world is the history that you haven't learned. What you will find is that successful leaders manage on the basis of reality and not ideology. So, I would say studying history is the best way to prepare because it does repeat itself. And I would offer to you two books for your consideration with summer coming up. I know you're busy, but with summertime, these two would be worth your time. The first is The Silk Roads, which is a history recently published that talks about both the Western and Eastern hemispheres, not just Eastern hemisphere from the standpoint of Western colonization. Very well written, very well researched, and certainly was an eye-opener for me. The second is Dereliction of Duty, written by H.R. McMaster, who happens to be the national security advisor to President Trump as we speak. Before he was promoted to general, he wrote this book, which was basically, if you will, almost an expose of the failure of the military, particularly, to have the courage to speak truth to power to President Lyndon Johnson in the late 1960s about the Vietnam War and the fact that we were fighting a losing war at great cost to our country. 58,000 young men and women died. A lot of money spent, and for what? It's an excellent book, and it happens to have been written as his PhD thesis for a PhD in history. So, I think that's the point that I wanted, those are the points I wanted to leave with you. I hope that they stimulate some thinking on your part about the Matrix. And as you engage in the world and start managing in the real world, I would ask, do your best to leave it better than you found it. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Asher, Lieutenant. At this time, I'd like to call up First Sergeant Robert Fournier from the Mass National Guard, Unit 1058, to tell us about Operation Desert Storm.
Must I?
You must.
Good morning. The last group that was here, I didn't quite go into a lot of details and was asked about it when everybody was walking around. So I'll give you a little background on me. I had a son who graduated from Hingham High School. I won't tell you what year, but he lives in Portland, Oregon today. So I'm a lot older than most of these people. Don't tell anybody. I enlisted in the military way back in 1957. And as I recall, six people left my hometown, me and five MPs. I volunteered. MPs are military police. That's supposed to be a joke. It didn't work, did it? Anyway, 1984, I joined the 1058 Transportation Company here in Hingham. By the time the Gulf War came along, or just before it, in September of 1990, we were at West Point, and I was promoted, at that time, I had come up through the ranks, and I was a platoon sergeant. My uniform is in the back, the desert uniform, which you'll get to see. It's way up there. As a platoon sergeant in the 1058, we are responsible for 10 vehicles, including a small vehicle that we used for the officer in charge of the platoon who would be my boss. And in my platoon at that time, I had about 32, 33 people in my platoon, four of which were females. And if I had my own way, I would have had a platoon of females because they knew how to take care of the trucks better than the guys did. The company has two platoons that have 20 vehicles. It has a third platoon that has 10 five-ton trucks, like the other two platoons have 20. They have 10 five-ton trucks and 10 tractor trailers. And they have, with those trailers, they have two trailers, so there's about 20 trailers. That's so that they can set one up, drag to a location, drop it off, pick up an empty one, and come back. That's what they were designed for. When the Gulf War came along, as we were at West Point at that time in August, when Saddam decided to jump into Kuwait and take over the sovereign country of Kuwait, we were at the West Point area supporting the cadets. It was their annual field training exercises that we, with trucks, would haul them to different exercise training areas so that they could fulfill their field training obligation for the whole summer. Along with us as a reserve unit, we were with the 101st Airborne Transportation Battalion that came up from Kentucky, Fort Campbell, to be with us at West Point. We got along famously with them. In fact, one of the truck masters who was in charge of the battalion motor pool, he and I became very good friends. We were the same rank. We were Sergeant First Classes, E7, which is the same as a Chief Petty Officer in the Navy, or a Master Airman in the Air Force, or a Gunnery Sergeant in the Marine Corps. We got so friendly when that news came to us, we were kidding and we said, we'll see each other in Iraq, because we supported, the 10-5-8 supported at that time, the 82nd Airborne Division out of Fort Bragg, North Carolina. When we went to leave the town of Hingham, we drove up Main Street all the way up. The streets were lined with people to see us off, which was very emotional, especially where I had a youngster in high school and a family. It's kind of tough to wave goodbye. But we rode up Main Street and proceeded to Fort Devens out in Ayer, Massachusetts for additional training. The active Army folks at Fort Devens assumed, remember what that is, that we, as a National Guard unit, were not prepared to undergo common task training, which includes, you know, putting on your chemical mask, learning about different types of explosives that you might come in contact with, like hand grenades, the different types of those, rifles, crew serve weapons, machine guns, that kind of stuff. They allocated some 4 to 5 weeks of training for us dumbbell truckers. We fooled them and did it in two. So they were amazed that we did it in two. For the next few weeks that we were there, until November, we had to do police details around the base to take care of the base. Once we left, we went to Springfield, Massachusetts, where the base there, Westover Air Force Base, we boarded C-141 flying transports and made the flight out of Westover towards Saudi Arabia. While in the air, it was unusual because I was sitting in the middle of the aircraft and the people in the back of the aircraft, there was a door that can drop down where they had pallets they could load things on. Not familiar, can look it up, Google a C-141. They were sweating in t-shirts and I was sitting up in the middle of the aircraft with a field jacket on and a blanket because it was so cold, the difference, because they had the tubes of air conditioning or heat going back that way. We didn't make out too well. We got there and it was like maybe 55 degrees on the aircraft, and stepped out into a pizza oven that had been on for a week. It was so hot. And we had to walk with our gear. We had duffel bags, backpacks, rifles, all the way from here to where your high school is. And then they put us in a tent, and in that tent there were pallets and pallets of water that had been there for a long time. And the water, I mean, you could probably cook an egg in it, that's how long, but they wanted us to drink it. If you recall, or if your parents recall, they sent over tons and tons of Kool-Aid. And the reason why they did that is because we have what they call a water buffalo that we haul around. It's a big tank a trailer that you put water in for drinking. Well, those water buffaloes in the desert with that kind of heat, that water would not survive. It would become very poisonous to you. So what we did was they'd put Kool-Aid in it. Well, they put bleach in it too. So if you walked by a water buffalo, you would smell like you were at a laundromat. So they get Kool-Aid so we could put it in our canteens and put the water in it, and that would take the taste away from how bad it was. After a while, it improved because the Saudi government gave us plenty of water. It was warm. It was always warm. During the day, it would be like 120, 125 degrees. At night, it would drop down to about 70. You'd wake up in the morning if you were sleeping on the sand, a lot of times we had to sleep out. You'd wake up and you'd find water all over your poncho because of the condensation. And the trick was, you could actually do this if you wanted to try it in the desert. Take a piece of plastic and stretch it out, dig a little hole and let it drain, and the next morning you'll have a thing full of water from just the condensation. Anyway, when the war started, we were with the 82nd Airborne, and we drove them into Iraq. We went about 700 or 800 miles up into Iraq at night, going crazy trying to see each other because we were driving with those little slits they call blackout lights, and all you can see is the red taillights in the back of a truck that you're following. There were about 1,100 vehicles that drove into Iraq. And if you remember the Hail Mary play that General Schwarzkopf talked about, where they were coming around this way, he was concentrated in Kuwait thinking that the Marines were going to make amphibious landings and evade through the Saudi border into Kuwait. Is that me?
Yeah, come this way. There you go.
Wow. I wanted to get closer. So what happened was, as we were up in that area, it totally took the Iraqi army by surprise. That's why there were so many of them that surrendered. And fortunately for us, we did live through some Scuds. That's a Soviet-built missile that they lobbed at us when we moved from Dammam to Riyadh, which is the capital of Saudi Arabia. Once we were in Riyadh, they put us at an airfield, a big one. It used to be the Saudi Arabian International Airport, but they were building a new one, the King Khalid Airport, which is now located about 35 miles further north. They weren't shooting at that one because they didn't know much about it. But this particular international airfield is on every map in the world, so they couldn't miss it. So they were lobbing Scuds at us, and luckily for us, we had the Patriot missile. The Patriot missile shot a Scud. Part of it broke in half, and a big piece of the tank, the fuel tank, landed maybe 200 or 300 feet from where we were camped out. And some of the guys, I don't know who it was, they went and grabbed it, put it by our mess hall tent, and put on it, Scud 0, Patriots 1. So we were very fortunate to have not just survived those things, because they were lobbing them and they were going all kinds of places. And luckily, I had observed that at least four of them were shot down by Patriot missiles, which was not a thing that they were designed to do. They were designed for aircraft, not missiles. But they worked. I don't know how they did it, but they worked. And we were grateful for that. When we got the word that the war was over and they had captured hundreds and hundreds of these guys, keep in mind, the Iraqi army was at war with Iran for over 10 years. So a lot of these fighters from Iraq had it up to here with war, and they didn't feel like fighting anymore, so a lot of them would surrender. They even surrendered to drones flying over, taking pictures of them. They're holding up flags to surrender, which was a good thing, because it would have been millions of people killed otherwise. So luckily for us, we went over there. The war ended. We stayed there longer than most people did because of the 10-5-8's motto is first in and last out. We were the first reserve unit to go active duty. Well, not really the first. The first unit that went active duty was a Transportation Army Reserve unit from Massachusetts that had 7 people. The Hingham group was more like 145 people. So we were actually the first big unit that was activated and went over to the Gulf. As you'll hear, the unit went over there again in 2004. And these ladies will be speaking to that in just a minute. But I gotta tell you, it was an interesting experience. The homecoming from Hingham, the town, was unbelievable. I don't think any town does what Hingham does when a unit or a soldier comes home than this town does. It's a great place. And I enjoy talking to you, and hopefully, who knows, some of you might join the military. I know it's kind of scary to be the leaders of the future, right? Okay. Class of 2019. With that, I'll say sayonara.
Thank you, First Sergeant. And now I have the distinct pleasure to introduce two other fighters, two other warriors from the 10-5-8, which is technically right down the street from here, right? That's that the armory over by the Lincoln School Apartments. This is a mother-daughter team. Yes, that's what I said, mother-daughter, serving at the same time in a combat zone. Specialist Jessica Pedraza and her mother, Sergeant Marilyn Gonzalez.
Hi, everyone. So a little bit about myself. I was educated in Rockland High. I was class of 2008. I was the only female varsity football player to ever play on that team. When I was in my junior year, I had a nice decision to make whether to go to college or what I was going to do. I had gotten accepted to 6 colleges, and my senior year, I felt I needed to give it up because I wanted to serve my country. That's all I wanted to do. So I enlisted February 22nd, 2008, while I was still a senior at Rockland High. I was 17 years old. She had to give me permission to go. I had went to basic training in Fort Jackson, South Carolina, September 11th, 2008. And for my graduation, when she came to my graduation, she had told me that the 10-5-8 was deploying again. They had deployed in 2004. They also deployed in 2007, I believe. And then my deployment was all of 2010, from January to December. So when I came home, I actually wasn't on the list to deploy because they had too many of the job that I had chosen. I was a supply specialist when I went in, and she was a truck driver. So her name was on the list and mine wasn't. So as a soldier, I'm pretty sure any of these guys will tell you, when you're faced with the decision whether to let somebody in your family go alone or you go with them, I volunteered. I was 18 when I got my driver's license, and the very first time I got on a highway was in a 2.5-ton truck with the Army. So we went, we landed January 8th, 2010 in Kuwait, and we flew out together. We didn't really get to see each other much out there, but we were both truck drivers. And when I say truck driver, I hauled tanks when we were out there. We were the biggest drawback mission in Iraq, so our main job was to get all the equipment that was brought out there from years before and bring it back to the ports in Kuwait so that it could be shipped back to the United States because Obama was closing out the wars. My truck was a 48-wheeled vehicle, so me standing here, I could swing the door like right over my head, because that's how big the truck was. So that's what we did. We did that for a whole year, you know, bringing equipment back and forth from Iraq to Kuwait. And I mean, those were some tough roads. There wasn't a mission that went by that we weren't being shot at or blown up or anything, you know. I mean, luckily we came home with everyone, but they made sure that they were going to give us a fight when we were out there. So when we came home, we had a nice little surprise because word had gotten out that, you know, a mother and daughter had deployed together. It was unheard of ever, and it happened in this state. So, I mean, Hingham gave us one of the greatest welcome homes. I'll never forget it. You know, it was freezing cold. It was Christmas Eve, and people were still standing outside for hours just to see our buses come by. Oh yeah, we had he's not here. It's actually one of the members here dressed up as Santa Claus and was on a motorcycle, and he brought us home. We came home Christmas Eve, so it was like coming home, you know, Santa was bringing us home. But I mean, you guys are gonna face that decision, you know, by next year. You guys are all gonna be trying to figure out what you wanna do. And you know, obviously she tried to pressure me into going straight into college. You know, that's how she wanted me to do it. But I just had something deep down inside me that I just wanted to serve my country. I feel like everybody should want to do that. When I came home, it was a little hard to readjust back to regular life, but I became an EMT. I've been working for Fallon Ambulance for the past 5 years. I'm in college now, hoping to transfer from Massasoit to Bridgewater by next year. And I mean, the Army's paying for it, so I can't complain. You know, even though I took 8 years out of my life, they're paying me back, you know, for everything that I did. And, you know, you guys are going to have a tough decision with everything that's going on with, you know, South Korea and Syria and all that. You have to do what feels right to you. And for me, it was at the time I wanted to join, and that's all I wanted to do. And I have no regrets at all. But I hope, you know, seeing a young face, a young female at that, because I'm pretty sure when you guys think of a veteran, you think of an older guy. And, you know, you have two females standing up here. And this is my mom. And she led by example. So I hope this is good and enjoyable for you guys to actually have some females up here.
Thank you, Specialist Sergeant. Let me see if I can navigate this for a minute, and we'll... I'm going to show two clips of my time in Iraq. I served at that time with the 27th Naval Construction Battalion. I've served in the Middle East, in Kuwait in 87, 1991, Iraq 2005, 2008, 2009, and Eastern Africa in 2014 and 15. The CBs, that's an acronym, as most military branches use acronyms, CB, so Construction Battalion, but our logo is a bee, an actual bumblebee with holding some tools in one hand and a rifle in the other, because our motto is we build, we fight. So I'm going to show you a couple of very short clips of what actually goes on. So that was a little bit of what we do. As you saw, those young men and women are out there working construction. Our usual shift, we used to call it 17-7. So you were 17 hours on, and then you had a rest period for 7 hours. Temperatures over there range from 120 degrees during the day on average to about 80 degrees at night. So that 40 degree shift in temperature was responsible for creating you to wear gloves, a hat, foul weather gear, we called it, because your body was tricked into thinking it was so hot during the day and you were working with all the heavy equipment on, your Kevlar vest, your helmet, a pack if you had to take it with you, the pack and the, what we call the rig, so that's what you guys would think is your bulletproof vest and your helmet and everything. The rig weighs 65 pounds alone. Again, it's 120 degrees out, so you're sweating all day. Night comes, that 40 degree temperature shift, and now you're freezing cold. So it's very confusing to your body. And as was mentioned by First Sergeant, water. You had to drink at least 6 liters of water a day just to really basically survive, because you sweated out that much. During the interactive portion of this program, which we were going to get to in a few minutes, I invite you to come to the rear of the hall where I'll be, and I have my rig. You can pick it up. It's got plates in it. You can see exactly what that felt like as a young man or woman serving, not much older than yourselves. As you heard, the specialist was 17 when she enlisted. Okay, so not very much older than where you are now. You're expected to tote everything you own on your back and on your person everywhere you go on all those missions. And you learn a lot. And you learn how valuable that your freedom is here, here in Hingham, and what you're going to be faced to do maybe over the course of your lifetime, maybe in the next 20 years. As was mentioned, you're our future leaders. So we're going to be looking to you to lead this country through what we've already lived through and fought for, which is freedom and democracy. So I have another clip. This clip is a little bit different, just as short, if you think it was long. This is kind of from the people that we left at home and what their point of view was. But it still shows scenes relative to Iraq. This is 08-09.
Turn out the light and hold your eyes.
It's been really hard on my mom.
I'm already there.
So I'm going to just take a few questions, and we're going to get ready to go to the interactive portion of this event, this field trip. If I can raise the screen, I'm going to start right here, which is one of the most important artifacts. Well, first, is there any questions about what you saw on that film? You saw the tape measure with that 4-inch mark. That was after a sandstorm. So just like we have snowstorms here, and you don't have school. Dr. Gallo calls off school because there's so much snow, right? That was 4 inches of sand that blew in overnight, and it was as dark as night when it blew in the middle of the day. So it obscures the sun, the moon if it's at night. You can't see anything. You literally cannot see your hand in front of your face. 4 inches of sand, just like snow. And guess what? You got to shovel that out, just like you got to shovel out your driveway. So that was an interesting fact of being over there, and just the heat. Putting up with the heat. The men and women to your left and right were part of your unit. Maybe you didn't like them before you left in training, or you know, in high school. I know the deal. Kind of. I have a family of my own, and when I'm gone for a year, you have to leave them behind. So. You may not like everybody that you run into, but when you're in a situation like that, everybody's your friend, because that's all you have to count on. So take that to heart. So looking up now that the screen is lifted, this is a 38-star flag, something you're not going to see every day. I invite you to look at those things. I'm going to move around the room rather quickly. There's artifacts. There's Civil War swords over here. There's some money up on that picture there. That's real Confederate money. That was brought home by some young man who walked to the Battle of the Potomac. So he might have been in Pennsylvania, he might have been at Bull Run somewhere. He brought that home as a souvenir. All these banners that you see on the wall are real banners that someone had in their hand at one time and waved. We framed them to save them for history's sake. A lot of the photographs are real. All the uniforms, I'm now over here on your right side. All those are uniforms are donated by Hingham men and women that have served. There's a little story about their awards and ribbons and what the actions that they saw. I invite you to go up on the stage. We have more uniforms available to look at. But as you turn around, the most prolific item up there that I see is that white cross with the flak vest, the helmet. There's boots. That is the remains of Corporal Christopher Orlando, 2012 graduate of the United States Marine Corps, who perished last winter in a tragic accident over Hawaii. His parents, now Gold Star parents, donated that to our museum here. As we go all the way back to the door that you came in, there's young men and women, well, there's young men on the wall who've perished in the line of duty. For whatever conflict they were in, it's written in the picture, and all these pictures were that are on this right-hand side above us all the way back to where I am now. These are actual photographs of those men that I mentioned to you that walked to battle from here, from Hingham, to fight in the Civil War for the Union Army. Hence why we're here today. This is the Grand Army of the Republic Memorial Hall. Everything you see here is a piece of history. For the next 30 minutes, I'm going to invite you to interact with the veterans, ask them questions that you may or may not have wanted to raise your hand for now. Up in the front is a model. We'll have U.S. Navy veteran Donnie Lincoln. He'll be up here to tell you about his service in during the late 50s, where he saw some action as well, a recipient of the Armed Forces Expeditionary Medal. In the rear, as I mentioned, I'll have my kit back there. You can pick it up. The pack is back there with the sleeping bag and this tent and everything, you know, and to see what that's really like. There's some MREs. MRE means meals ready to eat. And as the Korean War veteran Herm Mesmer told us, he used to have cans of food, so we don't have cans anymore. We have a kind of a bag or a sack that goes in our pockets. We carry at least one meal on our person at all times. And I can only speak for myself, but when I was in Iraq, about 16 kilometers from the Syrian border, way out in the western part of Iraq, we only had one hot meal a day. It was about 103 days before I actually saw a piece of fresh fruit. So all we had to exist for our sustenance was those meals. So there's a bag back there with some in it. We can look through those. You feel free to touch those. Scott McMillan is in the back with a weapons display. He can tell you what you can and cannot touch. So I urge you to interact now with the veterans. Look at the memorabilia on the wall. For some of you, this is probably the first time you've ever been in this hall, and I can probably imagine, as I said, this program only started 8 years ago. Your parents definitely have never been in this hall. So this is a hidden gem of Hingham. Please show respect and pride in this. And again, don't forget that sometime in the future, you know, fast forward 20 years, you could be standing up here at this microphone, and we've passed this on to you to pass on to the next generation. So, there will be a time for lunch, but that time is not right now, so you can leave your stuff at your chair if you'd like, because we'll be probably be returning to those spots. But get up now and interact and enjoy. Thank you for coming.
I would hope they would come away with a determination to find some way to serve their country. Doesn't have to necessarily be in the military. Could be. But give something back. Leave it better than you found it. And I think when you see people stand up who have served here in the military and talk about what it was like and the pride with which they talk about it, I'm hopeful that sets a good example for these young people.
I think the biggest takeaway would be that these veterans, men and women, live within their community. They may not even have known that that person served. They only may see that person as the fireman, as the postman, as the doctor that they go to, their father's lawyer perhaps, or their mother's accountant. But they're actually veterans. They're citizen soldiers from our community. So when they put the two together, it isn't that far-fetched. And I think what they see or may see or hear is that could be me someday. That could be my role later on. And it gives them an idea that there is something outside of Hingham, something that's bigger than themselves.
I really hope that they take away the history that these men and women that are standing up here were all a part of significant conflicts that happened in this country. And you know, just to respect your veterans and respect the people in the military and understand that there are people that this is what they choose to do. Now it's an all-volunteer army, but back in the Vietnam War, you know, they were drafting people and forcing people to go. I just feel like the history is incredible, and I feel like that's the most knowledgeable thing that these kids can have. I didn't get it when I was in high school, so I had to learn it on my own. It's not every day that they get to do this and have everyone from different conflicts at the same time talk about it. You know, it's different.